many supplement companies are making outright false claims. Unfortunately, there's not very good regulation around supplement claims. There is oversight there, but there's so many supplement companies that it's impossible for the FDA to properly regulate these companies, and they're not under FDA regulation. Supplements don't have to be approved to get put into the market. I can go and create a supplement today, put some claims on the label. The supplement can have somewhat of the ingredients that would support some of the claims that I'm making. So for example, I could say that it helps with blood sugar control because it has berberine, and berberine has been shown in some studies to help reduce blood sugar, but that dose that's been used in studies is 1500 milligrams, and I put 200 milligrams in there instead, and then I make this claim. This is how a lot of these supplements are marketed. Sometimes the claims are false. Sometimes the claims are made based on an amount of an ingredient that's not actually in the supplement. And also, in many cases, when consumer agencies go and test these supplements, about 40% of supplements don't even have what they say they have in them, sometimes higher than that, sometimes up to 60%. So if you purchase supplements from Amazon or from the grocery store even, there's a high likelihood that what it says it has in there is probably not what it actually has. In many cases, the doses are lower or potentially higher, and then sometimes there's banned agents in some of these sports supplements that causes individuals to test negative on drug tests because of the fact that these supplements are so tainted. So unfortunately, the supplement market, it's very difficult to navigate because it's a very lucrative industry. A lot of people will say big pharma. You hear this term thrown around a lot. Big pharma is evil. They're trying to make money off of us. But the supplement industry is larger than the pharmaceutical industry, and it's less regulated. Unfortunately, that makes it very difficult for the consumer, because while I'm saying all this, that also doesn't negate the fact that some supplements may be useful in some cases for some individuals when they're used in the right setting, in the right dose, the right form of the right supplement with the right person. Supplements can be very helpful as an adjunct to a healthy lifestyle. The place where supplementation is probably the most beneficial is identifying these nutrient deficiencies and also insufficiencies. There's a lot of cases where there's not an outright deficiency, but if you evaluate someone's nutritional intake and you identify that they are consistently under consuming magnesium, for example, which is quite common, and they are experiencing some symptoms of magnesium insufficiency, higher levels of stress, poor sleep, restless legs, things like that, there could be cases where supplementing with magnesium can be helpful. And so with these micronutrient deficiencies, that is the place where supplements are the most helpful. And then going beyond meeting those baseline needs, there's no value that's been demonstrated in any studies. We have certain nutrient needs that have been assessed over time, and they may be a little bit higher if you're a larger individual or you're an athlete, and there may be utility in getting a little bit higher vitamin B, for example, twice the daily dose or something along those lines. But the very high dose supplementation, where they're giving you IV B vitamins at doses that are 50 times what the normal daily value needs are, is pretty unnecessary, and there's no evidence to support any benefit from these things.
There's some lexicon and some language out there that supplements need to be an important part of our nutritional or dietary pattern because the quality or the level of nutrients in our food has declined significantly. As a nutrition scientist, what are your thoughts about that subject?
The discussion about the nutrient levels in our food declining, this was based on a study that was published in 2004 that showed over the past 50 years, some of the crops in the U.S. have slightly lower levels of some nutrients. It wasn't major decline on all the various nutrients, but various theories have come out around this, and you'll see people using this study in this particular point to create a variety of different narratives on social media. So I've seen people say that they're purposely taking the nutrients out of the food to make you sick, or the soil's depleted and there's no nutrients in the food. Like, number one, they'll exaggerate the actual decline. It's been a small amount, like 10 to 20% in 5 or 6 different nutrients. It wasn't a massive decline in every nutrient in the foods. And this was over the past 50 years. It wasn't because the soil has been depleted of nutrients and we can't grow food anymore. It's because we have learned to grow more food on less land. We've basically selected for the crops that will grow more yield per acre to be able to feed more people, to be able to make food more affordable, to make it more available and accessible. And that has resulted in a slight decline in some of those nutrients because you're just growing more food on less land, and those foods that thrive on less land tend to just have slightly lower nutrient content. And this has been discussed in studies that were published after that original study, but I've never actually seen that discussed on social media. Everyone uses that narrative to create a narrative around that particular paper.
In the field of neurology and neuroscience, because of memory problems, everybody's scared of losing their cognitive prowess and their memory. And so there is this huge body of individuals and companies trying to market supplements for improvement of their cognition. What are your thoughts about those, specifically for the ones that promise better cognition?
I've looked into that data several times. I haven't seen anything that shows any benefits in cognition, and I've seen many supplements claiming this. Now, there is one. There is an evidence base that's starting to build, and this one also has a very long history and safety profile, and that's creatine. Recently, there's been a few more studies published showing some cognitive benefits of creatine. There was a meta-analysis published last year that seems to be mostly among older adults, because creatine and our stores of creatine tend to go down as we age, and creatine is important for ATP production, so energy production at the cellular level. And so there's mechanistic reasons why that would be the case, and creatine has been used for decades now for sports performance because it does help with that energy production. So it's been used to enhance high intensity sports performance. And just recently, over the last 10 years or so, there's been more studies coming out showing that it may have some potential cognitive benefits as well. And it seemed to be more pronounced in older adults in terms of supplementation with creatine.
Would you actually tell a person to navigate in this world that is filled with misinformation? And when it comes to supplements, what do they need to do? 1, 2, 3, how should they approach it?
This is where finding the right sources is incredibly important. And also, if you have access to the right care in terms of a physician who's going to sit down and talk with you about your needs and things like that's also great. But a lot of times people are taking information from too many sources. So really taking your information sources and evaluating, what is this person's education? What is their experience? How are they presenting the information to me? Does it seem like they're trying to indoctrinate me or manipulate me into making a decision? Or do I feel like they're trying to provide me with information so that I can make an informed decision on my own? If you're identifying those things and you're being diligent about that, you should make your way towards the right sources. When you start to find those individuals, you'll start to find more of them, and then you can build your resource of individuals with different levels of expertise who are all doing these same things and providing quality information and doing it in an ethical way and trying to really help people. And it's difficult. Social media is, I'd say, over 90% of the information is not the type of information that you want to be consuming, but you also have these pockets where you can get really high quality information that you wouldn't have access to otherwise for free from experts in their field.